board starting right now. I just started. I thought you were doing it.
I couldn't do it. I think when you joined as host, I couldn't. Okay, thanks.
Okay, good. Now, Anna, you're off mute. Does that mean you're ready to introduce yourself?
Sure. Hi, I'm Anna. This is my first time at this gathering. What did you want me to say about myself?
Well, mainly, where are you? Where are you today?
Oh, yes.
What's exciting right now in a couple of sentences that you're experiencing around your climate change work?
Okay. I'm in Oakland, California at the right now I'm in the HQ of BNBC where I work. And let's see, I have been off the scene of climate change work for a little while since I moved to the Bay Area about 9 months ago. So I'm just excited to be here.
Great. Glad to have you. Thanks for joining us. Let's see. I have a couple of Johns that look like they're still quiet, ready to speak up. Introduce yourselves. John Kelly, here they go. Thank you.
Okay. Can you hear me all right?
Yes, just fine.
Great. So I'm joining you again from Berkeley. I missed a few sessions. What's exciting for me in relation to our topic today, I am working with a company. It's called Quantelia, and we're navigating the difficult space of doing a quasi pro bono work that's quite complicated and expensive. But we're basically building a model for greenhouse gases for a small city that would take into account very complicated interactions between parking and car use. A lot of it is around mobility, and trying to do that in a way that not only makes sense technically and is defendable technically, but will yield something that is collaborative, that would be able to be put in front of citizens with little dials and buttons that they could turn. They could turn up or down the parking price. They could turn up or down the, some other kind of restrictions, and they could see the impact over decades, both on greenhouse gas and on other quality of life variables. So it's exciting, it's difficult, and it's, for lack of a better word, it's not so much controversial as it's really hard. It's not like people are actively opposing it. It's more like people are scratching their heads and saying, help me understand, what you're doing. It's really
glad to have you, John, and thanks for bringing that activity. Sounds promising. Let's see, where did John go? The other John that was muted. I don't see him right now. Hi there, Anna Lewis. Are you ready to introduce yourself? A couple of minutes about what's exciting you right now about your work in climate change and where you are sitting today. Yeah, talk. Can you talk?
She just wrote something in that she can only hear and not talk. So why don't we go to Sandy? She hasn't introduced herself yet.
Okay, I didn't see Sandy, but Sandy, please.
Yes, hi. I'm Sandy Heyerbach. I'm the director of NCDD, National Coalition for Dialogue and Deliberation. If anybody doesn't know, I think most of you are members. And I'm here because you're talking about network building, and I'm very interested in that aspect of the call. And although I don't think I'm involved in any climate change work directly, so many of our members are working on it, and I'm thrilled that you guys are connecting via this platform. So
great.
Glad to be here. Check out what you're doing.
Thank you. And I now have switched over to page two. So I see we have Andrew Gaines also on the line. Andrew, welcome. Could you introduce yourself?
Good morning, everybody. I'm calling from the Blue Mountains outside of Sydney, Australia. And what excites me is my own work, which is a vision of, Naomi Klein is calling for a network of network, a movement of movements. That's focused primarily on, as far as I can tell, still focused on combining groups for protest and policy change projects, all of which are important. But the vision I carry is, what if members of all these networks become citizen educators with a unifying vision of transitioning to a life-sustaining society and using that as a kind of a marketing meme, if you will, with the intention of educating the general public to a new sense of possibility for our times.
Great, Andrew. We're happy to have you a part of us. What time of day or night is it there in Australia?
Good question. 7:20. I had to pry my eyes open.
Okay. Thank you for doing so. Glad to have you. Has everyone introduced yourselves except for me that I'm not seeing on one screen or another? Oh, there you go, Nancy. Okay.
Yeah. First, I want to apologize. I've been trying to figure out Kiko chat. I was trying to find a chat. I was very worried about the recording, and I couldn't figure out how to communicate with anyone about it. And there were all these great things being said. So I want to make a request. If you, either in the notes that are being taken or in a chat, could jot down like the contact information or name of or something, when you introduced yourselves, said really exciting things about yourselves and also the name of projects and stuff that you're involved in, and it didn't get recorded. So if you could somehow get that, at least a link or a name, into one of the written records right now, it would make me very happy. And I haven't been very present. I couldn't even hear much of what you're saying because I'm so busy with that technical problem. And for myself, what excites me right now are three things: our Quaker meetings, growing involvement with interfaith work in Santa Cruz, California, where I live. And a second thing is we're also getting very, very involved with justice issues, racial and justice and restorative justice issues here. And I'm always have been with homeless issues. And I'm really very caught up in the question Andrew Gaines was raising, doing a lot of writing and thinking about it. So Andrew, I will be in touch with you because much of what you said, the whole notion of resilience and how it brings together both our concerns for climate and our concerns for community and humanity in our midst. So those are the things right now. And my dear friend from our Quaker meeting and one of my primary persons that I talk about systems theory and a lot of these things specifically, I'm interested in how networks are moving forward and can even more move this kind of work forward. So, Naomi, you want
to? Well, I'm basically just glad to be here and to reconnect and connect with my sense of grounding and faithfulness around this work.
We're glad you're here. Thank you for joining us. So today I'm sitting in St. Petersburg, Florida, happy to be joining you on so many different parts of this beautiful planet, and hope you've had a lovely day or you're about to have a lovely day. And as far as what's exciting me is the feeling that the traction is actually occurring. Seems like so often there's a sense of spinning your wheels, you're not seeing your outcomes, and I feel there's such abundance of so many different things. To be brief, as I've asked you to do, I'll show you my excitement. This says, sea level rise, what's our next move? St. Petersburg College partnered with the Institute on, let's see, what's it called here? For Science for Global Policy. And they did an issue on sea level rise here with us in October. And then in November, they did one in Toms River, New Jersey, about after Sandy. So we have some extraordinary resources and references in these two books that I just showed you. They just arrived. So my story of excitement is that we're continuing to look at this issue of sea level rise in St. Petersburg, in Pinellas County, and the Tampa Bay area in a very collaborative networking way. So that's me for today. Have we, had someone else?
Yeah, this is David Sinclair in Tampa. I just joined you. Thank you. Hello.
Hi there, David.
Hi, Sharon Joy.
And Lucas Chaffee in Charlottesville, Virginia. Hi, Sharon Joy.
Hi, Larry. Glad you're here. And each of you were taking a couple of minutes to say where we are, so you took care of that. And what's exciting you about climate change today? Just a couple of sentences, or briefly, if you will, please.
This is David in Tampa. What excites me about the issue at present is the willingness to use new vocabulary, the willingness to use words like resistance, willingness to use words like holy. Basically, we're willing to use new vocabulary, but I think we're becoming more courageous every moment.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Lucas, what about you?
This is Lucas. I would say what interests me is how interdisciplinary the challenge is, and any solution is going to require many hands.
Well, thank you, everyone, and welcome to the discovery of what's happening today. Our topic, as you know, is on the power of networks. And Rosa, I bet you're primed to pick up.
All right. Thank you so much, Sharon Joy. I notice a few of you have been helping out with notes. I'm not going to be doing much of the writing at this point, because instead I'm going to be calling on people as we move into this next part of our conversation. So the questions that we came up with, and you certainly don't need to limit yourself to these, but these are the conversation prompts, are: what have you experienced as part of successful networks? What gave them life and meaning? And what worked? So it's a kind of appreciative inquiry, trying to harvest the learnings from our best examples with networks. So just going to invite anybody who starts to jump in. And so this is a little bit like the intro, maybe, you know, three or four sentences a piece or a paragraph, but not more, because we do want to hear from each person. So who would like to start?
This is David in Tampa. I missed the second part of the question. I heard you say, what have I experienced in these lively networks? What was the second part, please?
Yeah. What have you experienced as part of successful networks? And what gave those networks life and meaning? What worked about them? So if you have
Thank
had
you.
The experience. And, you know, we don't want to. Yeah. Okay. Go ahead.
I'll think about an answer later. Thank you.
Okay. I also did want to say that we don't want to limit people too much. So, I mean, if you can't think of a positive experience, but you have an experience of something that didn't work and you learned something from it and you're like, next time I'm going to do this differently, that's welcome as well.
No, I have some ideas. I just can't think. I just came in from outside, so give me about 2 minutes.
Oh, absolutely. I wasn't saying that specifically to you. I was saying that to everyone in general.
Thanks.
Yeah.
I just raised my hand. If you look in the upper left of your screen, if you have the notes page up, you will see that you can get the attention of the moderator by clicking the raise your hand button. The other way is to just wave your hand literally in front of the camera. the only thing that I would like to say in answer to your question is, several minds are always better than one. We all come with different perspectives, different experiences, and by tapping into what other people's expertise and knowledge is, we can leverage off each other, and the group will be much better than any one individual can be.
Thank you so much, Bob, and thank you for the technical tip as well. Really appreciate that. So several minds better than one. And Anna, you have your hand raised as well?
Yeah, I have a few different things I'd like to share. I mean, what leaps to mind when you talk about successful networks is, when I lived in Portland, I worked with this interfaith group called EcoFaith Recovery. They're only, as far as I know, they're still only in the Portland area, sadly, because they're amazing. And what I really loved about them was, for one thing, they were super clear on their mission not being to lead, like, to like lead campaigns, but to nurture leaders, people who could be leaders within their faith communities. So nurturing a network of leaders rather than providing the leadership themselves. Mm-hmm. And they had very thoughtfully developed a set of practices that they thought would work for nurturing leadership. And they were constantly like revising, like having feedback on them and revising them. And the practices themselves were wonderful. They were very holistic with, prayer and singing and things like that, in addition to more, you know, whatever mental activist type stuff. I really loved working with them because it was very empowering and very juicy, like the meetings, because of the singing and the prayer and the heart in it. It was a very nourishing experience. And then recently I got asked for my organization to participate in a new network called the Nonviolence Training Hub, they're doing something called the 1000 Nonviolence Trainings Project, but they're trying to get nonviolence trainers from all over the world to work with them. What I really liked, what made me want to join them right away, is that they had really clear and doable steps to join and contribute to the network. And then recently I started my own network project. We at BNVC, we're offering a course starting this summer, a teleclass called Working for Transformation Without Recreating the Past. So it's about how you create social transformation. And we asked a bunch of partners to help lend their names to this class and help create the syllabus and so on. And I tried to follow the same model of having really concrete actions that people could do if they resonated with the vision and wanted to contribute to it.
Awesome. Thank you so much for all those very concrete and inspiring examples, Anna. That's great. Beth, did you have your hand up?
Sure, yeah. I can share two examples that are somewhat similar about some of the more effective networks I've seen, one of which some of you may have heard of, which is the REAMP network in the Midwest at the Garfield Foundation. Created, which got basically, I think it's about 8 states now, advocates and foundations all doing a combined system mapping exercise so they could align their work and their funding around what were the biggest leverage points to move towards greenhouse gas reductions and create a clean energy future. And that continues to this day. There's colleagues of mine who built on that in Vermont. It's a case study that's not out there as much as I keep bugging my friend to get it written up, but Energy Action Network of Vermont, look at their website, but they did a similar exercise in Vermont because the funder was recognizing she would talk to people all over the state about what was needed for clean energy, and everybody working in the state that small had a different view of the system and the problem and a different set of solutions. So they did a systems mapping exercise. And in their case, they really reached beyond just the environmental energy advocates. They tried to get as broad a group, including big business. They had IBM at the table. They had government, all the activists and stuff. And together, coming up with the audacious goal of pretty dramatic greenhouse gas reductions, transitioning Vermont to clean energy, and together coming up with 4 leverage points for action. And that model, I think, was so interesting because the leverage points, because you had more of the system in the room, were things like we need to mobilize a huge amount of capital. And, you know, to sit in these meetings and see the state treasurer sitting with people in Vermont who work with investors that invest billions and know how that part of Wall Street works and things. So because they got a different mix of people, not just environmentalists fighting business and these folks saying what the solutions should be, but they got a broader table looking at the system, they were able to, you know, put some ambitious goals in for the state of Vermont and then get these leverage point action groups working on it, including one, John, to your point, a whole one on making Montpelier a net zero city with a whole online community dashboard, somewhat similar to your thing. And one of the best practices from Andy Combs, the director, who's a really good network thinker. He's always like looking for what is it that we can do as a network that is the thing that needs to be done across the system or the space no one's in yet. Like, we incubate things. So they did a whole clean energy finance summit to like create that conversation and get all the different players thinking and talking about it. And then she's always looking to how then can we roll that out and have network members take it over and the network itself be the convener of the next question or the next joint need. And one final piece in that story is when the state of Vermont went to do its climate action plan, because all the key stakeholders had already spent a couple years coming to agreement, they basically adopted that plan. And so Wow. It's like this, what I also find exciting is the network serves as sort of a standing, well, it's like a group of stakeholders government can turn to and say, we need stakeholder input. They got everyone already there. Come to our meeting for 2 hours. Government doesn't have to do its own huge stakeholder input thing every time it makes a big energy decision in the state. They've got everyone like a standing stakeholder team there. So great case study to study about networks, both that and REAMP. So thanks.
Thank you, Beth, for these inspiring and
I'll put some links.
Super educational stories. Thank you so much. Who's next?
Well, I have my hand raised, so.
Oh, great.
Miles. I'm actually going to offer a slightly different perspective. I have fairly negative experiences of things that call themselves networks, which is funny since I build networks for a living, and I spent 12 years running the Center for Civic Networking. It's a definitional thing. I have seen networking and networks as a very effective when organized around something else. For example, you know, every open source software project has a user email list, a developer email list, some usually some computer resources that are sort of the focal point for building software. But it's the project that's the organizing principle, not the network. Same thing for organizations or communities, like the board of directors or the email list for a church. Or for that matter, the Internet Engineering Task Force is probably 10,000 people who run the internet. But it's an organization and a process that happens to use a lot of networks, particularly email lists, but also conferences. And an awful lot of communities of interest or communities of practice are networked in some way. But when it comes to, oh, we are building a network in a vacuum, I have, you know, less experience of that actually working or doing anything. You know, it's sort of it's vacuous in a sense. You know, it's having something. It's having a purpose or a focus or something that seems to be the key, and networking is a great tool.
Great. Thank you, Miles, for emphasizing the importance of having a purpose and a focus to your network. Great. Barb.
Yeah. I want to build on a lot of what's been said, beginning with the necessity of building that common social ground. And I want to push back a little bit on the idea that a network is something that gets built. I think a network gets grown. And if you can see this, I want to share a book called Connecting to Change the World. If I was going to write a book after 40-something years of this work, this is the one I wish I would have written. Because what they've done here, and I can let you see the authors, what they've done here is they've done an enormous amount of work in actually taking apart some really wonderful generative networks and coming up with principles of what works and what's not working. And they come up with principles like, let the network do the work. It needs to be self-organizing. The work I've done with the Intentional Endowments Network, which is the intentionalendowmentsnetwork.org, we used a lot of the principles we know about from dialogue and deliberation in terms of the way you bring a community together. And it decided to become a network in which university administrators and presidents and people who are seasoned in intentional investing and social investing are now working together to figure out how you do this on the university level. But they're doing the work, they're calling the questions. It is an organic organization. I think that's a really important part of it. And Connecting to Change the World is one of the most practical books on this topic I've ever read.
Thank you so much for the resource, Barb.
You're welcome.
Now, who's next?
This is David in Tampa. What I'd like to share is related to process within the growth of networks. Or another word is how to keep the network alive past the first few meetings. I have four points here. One is I find that in the building of networks, whether face-to-face or over the phone, if we are willing to share personal feelings, if we're willing to share the barriers that we face, it somehow builds a solidarity that is so valuable. Second, I believe that if we get into the practice of affirming and showing our respect for the others there, it builds up a lot of trust, and I think that's a tremendous glue. Another point I think is that consistent attendance is important. It gives the facilitator trust that this is, you know, the right calling. And finally, I think, and it's worked with me, is to give the facilitator, call them separately, email them separately, and give them a feedback, especially if you have facilitation skills yourself. Often those who organize networks don't have those skills. And I think that that's a wonderful way to keep a network alive.
Great. Thank you so much for your input. Who's up next?
Oh, here.
Yes, Nancy.
No, this is actually Leoma.
Leoma.
A query that arose after hearing about that very successful network in Vermont, it was, right? Where there was actually a stakeholders network waiting. How would such a network be built in a larger state or a larger population, I think like California or New York State, which is much more diverse, both geographically and in terms of the pull of its interest. So it's just a query that arose in my mind, how to reproduce that.
Yeah, it's a good question. And in terms of the Vermont one, I think one of the key things is to have enough funding from foundations at the start. You know, they put a significant amount of consultant and facilitator and mapping resources to kind of hold it at the front. California actually has an interesting network that's developed. It's called California Delivers. And that one was, you know, when they had the, I forget the name of it, AB 32 or whatever, you know, had this landmark climate thing. And then the opposition was able to get a huge ballot initiative trying to like kill it on the ballot. And so everyone who wanted clean energy had to get organized quick, very clear goal and target. And in that case, I heard a great talk by Resource Media, which is a media communications firm. And given that situation, they formed this huge collaborative network all around how to deliver the clean energy message and like different avenues for business and others. But in the need to create a clear message and advocate for a policy across a state that big, it gave them the vehicle to get the faith groups and the grassroots and the environmental justice folks and the business, clean energy business people, all like singing with a similar tune on clean energy. So I think that's one answer of it. It can somewhat look different in different states. But the REAMP one, you know, that one spreads across 8 states looking at policy. So that there are different models for how to do it. But I think the having a process to some extent, I totally agree with your point, Barbara, that it's enough structure, but then it's all around finding the common ground and the self-organized shared interest and, you know, creating space for the people to do the work to work together. but it can't happen in absence of the collaborative architecture and the support to convene the meetings thoughtfully and all that. I think you need both.
So. I'll have a different description in answer to your question, Leoma. And my theory has been to start with a small enough container that you can start to create some coherence among a wide diversity of players. Just like if you put water in a pot, a smaller pot, it's going to boil faster than putting the water in a big skillet. I think that's true. Maybe it doesn't work that way. But well, we started off with the city of St. Petersburg, with as many parts of the diversity in our region, the whole system of government and business and nonprofit and grassroots and schools and young people, et cetera. And so the container seems to have on its own, I think that's what you were saying, Barb, you don't build it, it does it. And finding the nodes of networks themselves creates it growing faster. And so we started here in St. Petersburg in 2001 with the intention to demonstrate how love can transform a community. And then it jumped. And now the Tampa Bay, it's all Tampa Bay, pretty much not percolating, but asystemically back and forth. But again, whole system engagement, looking at social issues, environmental issues. And now with our expanded horizons, the whole state of Florida is jumping in using this tool, KikoChat. So we've organized the Florida Climate Action Network that's separated into the regional planning councils. We have a very strong regional planning council leadership here. Planners, we work with the Tampa Bay Water, you know, so we're looking at the water, we're looking at fracking, we're looking at solar. Other important piece, I think, is to focus on what's growing. Let what isn't growing go. Let it rest, let it die, whatever it needs to do. No focus on fixing something that's broken, but following where the energy is, which is what we seem to do in a dance, to move from a Florida ethic to, excuse me, a water ethic to a solar ethic to a food ethic, so that you can start to coalesce around something that's working and positive. Not that how many feet the water is going to rise in St. Petersburg by X number of years isn't important, but you got to have the other data of hope.
Beautiful, Sharon Joy. Thank you so much. So it's interesting. I'd like to take a moment to just offer a meta comment here. As I started hearing some of these stories, I realized, you know, what if there isn't just one way to build a good network? Like, wouldn't that be wonderful if there were a number of different ways? And I do think that different stories can give us a lot of tips and ideas, because if we know that something worked well, and I know that the work you've done has been amazing, Sharon Joy, and the work that you've shared with us, Beth, is incredibly inspiring. So each of these stories carry embedded in them so many wonderful ideas, inspirations, principles, things that we can learn from them. And maybe we don't have to be trying to figure out the one and only way, but just looking at what can we learn from successful instances. So thank you all so much. Anyone else have a story of something that worked or didn't work or that you'd like to see work? Yes.
Well, I'm in Tucson, Arizona, and what I'm noticing in the networks that I've been hanging with here, there's a lot of siloed networks. We are just right at this time, just chomping at the bit to get together and to do something bigger. And what I'm noticing that's causing it really is climate change. I mean, a lot of these groups, I was quite active in the sustainability movement about maybe 9 years ago when I first came to Tucson, and these same groups were there, but there wasn't really any communication between them. Now, not only is there communication, but they're actively looking for ways to put the networks together. And so the next step that I can sense into is we simply need to kind of do what you were talking about, Beth. But my big question, Beth, and any of you who have worked in local networks and building them, where do you find the financing? I mean, Garfield had deep pockets. I don't remember how much they spent, but it was a huge, massive amount of money that went into the eight-state collaborative over, I don't know, 5-6 years. So I mean, I would love to jump in. Many people who have organizational skills would like to do this, but where do you find the funding to really bring this together and keep it together? Because to keep it sustained, you have to have, you know, that funding source.
I'd like to jump in because there's nobody funding us at all. So there's another part of the story. It's people funding themselves with their own energy and their own passions. It's self-generating. We find each other and we dance and we play and we raise the vibration of opportunity, of excitement and synchronicity. Unheard of ideas happen. I'll tell a story later about one of those. So I think scarcity can get in our way. Is you just step out and try it.
Yeah, I'm appreciating what you're saying, Sharon Joy, and at the same time, I'm reminded of what an incredible resource we have in our elders, which is something that Grady was mentioning before. You know, when we have people who have already accumulated the resources that they need to live and are able to donate their time in order to make a difference in the world, that is just such a tremendous resource to be able to draw on. Yes, Beth?
Oh, and I would say, you know, sometimes with these networks I've seen, I know Garfield, that's one of the problems with the model, but, you know, I've worked with a number of foundations, and I think foundations are moving as well to see the importance and the need for this. Certainly look at United Ways across the country are starting to say, the whole collective impact model, like we want to be in a convener role. But a really well-designed network sometimes isn't a huge amount of staff. Like I've been working with coaching someone who was in the consultant role for a new national network connecting affordable housing and energy efficiency people across the country. And, you know, that was largely one full-time equivalent. And then over time, they realized it would make a lot of sense to hire like a meeting event coordinator. This is another really good practice because so much network stuff is scheduling meetings and taking notes and getting everyone there and all that. And so the network recognized the work group leads who are the people doing the work or, you know, excited about every day. If they could have one support function do all that for them, they can show up and like do the work. So it's, you know, if you don't have a lot of resources, it's also trying to be tactical about what's the minimum of structure and convening and support to let the people that come together and find the connectivity, you know, go do the work. But I've seen ones where they're not funded and they totally struggle. You know, if you don't have strong coordination and someone keeping the ball moving or making the connections, that's one of the kind of fundamental conditions that's pretty important in the ones I've seen really thrive and the ones that kind of struggle along. So, yeah.
This is David in Tampa. I wanted to share briefly something that I believe does not work. A model that I'm discovering that probably does not work on a very large statewide scale. That is, we assume that when a pledge is signed and we get a list of all those who signed a pledge, like a pledge to act on something, that just signing the pledge really does not mean that the person wants to act on the issue or can act on the issue within their context. So I just want to share that getting people together often on a very large geographical scale when they only have in common something as, let's say, as minor as having signed a document, really is not as good of a way to organize as Sharon Joy was explaining on smaller levels.
Thank you. Sandy, are you still here with us? You've had a lot of experience with networks, and I was wondering if there was something you wanted to share.
Yeah, hey, Rosa, how are you doing? I'm multitasking a little bit, but listening with interest. In terms of what has really worked for us, And NCDD is more of a community of practice than a collective impact kind of network, but once in a while we are able to come together and make something happen together. Our conferences are a very good example of that because we always do those collaboratively with the whole network. But also, once in a while, we'll have a project. There was one called the Core Principles. We created the Core Principles for Public Engagement together. That was before, actually right after Obama became president and the Open Government Memorandum came out. And we realized that as a field, we didn't have a collective definition for public engagement or a set of principles that we all agreed on. We had different sets of principles. So we came together, we had conference calls, we had lots more people involved in an online process. We had to have a couple of people that were behind the scenes really doing the bulk of the work. And that's always, I think, that's always key, even in conference planning, but it was definitely key in this core principles project. But one of the things that has always worked for us, no matter what the project is making sure that everybody knows that they have options for getting involved. We've always been very transparent about, you know, what we're doing, how people can be involved, what the opportunities are to be involved. Even with the NCDD website, a lot of people create a kind of a closed network, or a lot of associations require people to pay dues, which we don't do, and have members-only sections on their site. So they kind of close off very valuable things from people that aren't part of the network, and we don't do that either. We've always made sure that everything was open and transparent. What else? I would say, you know, our network is known for people being very generous with their knowledge and the information that they have, the experience that they've had working in the field. And so having a very easy way for people to communicate with each other, and for us it's been our main listserv, that's a very busy listserv, that has been really key for us, something that's had longevity, that people know how to use, it's very easy, and people know that if they send the message that has some real heart to it, you know, here's what I'm asking of the community, I need your advice on engaging people around this issue in this context, and here's why I need help, they'll get a whole bunch of different responses from people, really, you know, people who in some ways are competing with each other for scarce resources, giving each other, you know, kind of insider secrets on how to do the work best. So I don't know if some of you others that are members have other input, but I think those are some of the things that we've found make people feel connected to the network and want to keep to stay involved.
Thanks so much, Sandy.
Sure.
Yes. Was that you raising your hand, Barbara?
Yes. I wanted to build a little bit on what Sandy said, because there's something that I think she does that's really important that she wouldn't talk about herself saying, but I've been on her board for almost 6 years now. And what I observe is in other organizations like this that are voluntary, as they get bigger, they become hierarchical and the people at the top start trying to make decisions. They don't let the network do the work. And the one thing about Sandy is that she constantly keeps her board honest and reminds us that we don't make the decisions, that the network makes the decisions, and we're always putting the question back out to the group. I think that's a really important principle that we look at and not make the mistake of when something becomes larger, adopting the behaviors of a hierarchy as opposed to what's needed for a network, which is to help it stay in touch with itself so it knows where it wants to go.
Mm-hmm. Thanks so much, Bob.
Yeah.
This is Beth. I just want to build on that because I just wrote a blog about this, which I ended up writing a 3-part blog. I had so much to say, but to the leadership aspect of networks and collaboration, I'm sure you've seen this as well, and just a lot of facilitation work, but the ethic of the network is the network leads and decides. It's a we. And so what it means for those in a whatever leading coordinating position, you really are always kind of stepping into the unknown to figure out, you know, we're going to ask the question of the network and then decide what the priorities are. And in my experience, that's one of the real hardest things for leaders to get, because they're so used to being leadership and hierarchy being, I have a plan or I'm an advocate and I'm going to push my ideas. So I'm learning all that to lead and always go back to the group to decide where things go next is a real leadership challenge and kind of a whole new set of learning to get comfortable with, like getting used to that uncertainty as you lead. And if you do it well, you get an answer everyone agrees with and then you move forward. But just want to name that as one of the real challenges I've seen.
Thank you, Beth. Yes, Sharon.
Yes, I'd like to speak a little bit to something that Niles talked about as a network, simply as a network, because it's something that I've noticed before. It's a little bit parallel, so see if this makes sense. I had not faced race riots until I lived in St. Petersburg in 1996. We did have race riots, and I showed up to see what should I do, what could I do without having a clue. And we began having conversations with people, getting to know people of different backgrounds. It was all very productive, great fun, had some nice relationships that continue today, actually, that we network and take action. Over time, in fact, I'm going to one next week at a church close by where we're going to be coming together to address issues of difference and race. I don't find those productive at all. I've also been invited to be part of conversations to figure out how you get olders and youngers to come together in conversations. You're talking about the subject. What I find energizing is when people are drawn from a common passion to show up and dig in a community garden or to address issues of social and economic and education injustice. The passion that pulls you brings together people of all ages, of all colors, of all backgrounds. So I can see where a network, simply to be a network, wouldn't feel like it had any energy. I don't have time to be in a network that isn't doing something that doesn't give me meaning. So that's my comment on that network, Miles. Thank you for bringing it to my awareness.
Thank you, Sharon Joy. I also hear a commonality with that and the gentleman who spoke earlier saying something about how ineffective it might be to try and bring together people just because they've taken a small action, like putting a signature on something. So I just have heard this theme a number of times about the importance of what is the call to action, the commonality, the shared work. I don't necessarily want to shift gears on the topic, but I do want to invite, just make some space here for people who haven't spoken at all. I don't think we've heard from Andrew or Forrest or I don't think John Kelly has spoken since the intros. Mike Huggins, I'm not sure. Anyway, so I don't mean to put anybody on the spot, but I do want to invite if we might hold some space for people who haven't spoken yet, if they choose to speak.
This is Andrew. Fantastic conversation, and I'm just absorbing it. Thanks.
Okay, great. Good to hear your voice, Andrew. Yes, John.
Yeah, this is John. Many of you, it sounds like, have spent time in networks that were more focused and committed than the ones in which I've spent a lot of the last, say, 5 years in. I've been in these kind of big, sprawling, unfocused networks. There's one out here called Next Now. There's another one, which is the membership of the Long Now Foundation. There's another one I'm working on now, working on a simulation center, a Bucky Fuller Center for Silicon Valley. So these things are very loose. They're all volunteer. They're all no money. You know, they get together socially. It's potluck. You know, very low resource and very low hierarchy. They can be the spawning grounds for a more focused subnetwork. That's the interesting insight that I've had. And a tricky thing is to sort of balance the tolerance, a positive tolerance, between the folks who are kind of coming in around the edges. Maybe they're there mostly for social reasons or for some other kind of reason, you know, and that's just fine. You let them do that, and you still work on growing the more focused network inside the big sprawling low commitment network. It hasn't been a completely satisfying experience. I've been frustrated, frankly, with the unfocused nature of NextNow and the unfocused nature of some other groups I've been in. But I have been able to pull out people from those groups and say, okay, now let's work together as a smaller group, be more dedicated.
Cool. Thank you, John.
So can I ask a question here?
Sure, but can we hear from Grady first since he hasn't spoken?
Yeah, I've been listening, kind of scanning my past to think of examples of networks, and I realize that I'm not sure I've participated in many networks at all. What drew me in part to the conversation was thinking about my positive experiences with what I realize are communities of practice. But I'm noticing that are getting more clear than I was on the fact that a community of practice I think has more formal structure and more usually more clear leadership of some kind. But I'd be curious to hear people speak to that. What do you perceive to be the boundaries between a community of practice and a network?
Great question, Grady. Thanks. Thanks so much. And yes, you had a question as well, Miles?
Well, actually it talks a little bit to Grady's question. I'm curious how people are defining network. I mean, it seems to cover a rather broad, we're using the word in lots of different ways. And, you know, as an engineer, a network is a computer network or an email list or Facebook in a sense. But in an organizational sense, we're talking about lots of different things. Mm-hmm. The Bernie Sanders campaign is a self-organizing network of lots of people doing lots of things. Campaigns in general tend to be networks of people. An email list, a community of practice, a community of interest. And I'm just curious, it's a term that is used in so many ways as to be almost meaningless.
Well, that's
so I'm wondering what it is that we're actually talking about.
Yeah, Miles, thank you so much for the invitation. I think that, I think we create meaning together, and one of the great ways that we can go about creating meaning is inviting more concreteness, more level of detail from one another, and that's what I'm hearing in your invitation. So for me, a very generative question in groups is often, it has to be said very curiously and lightly because tone is really important. So it's like, I'm curious, what do you mean when you say network, right? Which is a little different than, well, what do you mean when you say network, but I do think that kind of curiosity about the meaning that each of us has about the way we use words can really help us to learn a lot from one another, whereas if we just take the word and stay at the surface, we may be really talking past each other because we're really using the same word to point to a lot of different things. So thanks so much, Miles.
Actually, I want to elaborate on that a little bit, if I might. Years ago, when we were setting up the Center for Civic Networking, our basic mission was a bunch of us who had grown up with the internet, built parts of the internet, were inspired by the notion of electronic town halls. Now, the internet had just gone public, and a bunch of us were inspired then by the question of what is an electronic town hall. We thought we had an answer,
because the internet had like a 10-year history at that, actually 20-year history of self-organizing in terms of its governance. And we had some idea of what an electronic town hall might look like. And you know, we were going back and forth. Are we building a civic network, or are we exploring the practice of civic networking? And so in some sense, I'm wondering if, you know, when someone says networking, or we're building a network like the Climate Action Network, is it really something concrete, or is it bringing a set of practices to a particular problem or situation or community?
Beautiful, thank you. So is it a noun or is it a verb?
Exactly.
Yeah, cool. Nancy, is that your hand waving, or is that Leoma's hand waving?
Leoma's hand waving.
Okay.
So I'm adding to that question of, is it a noun or a verb, the question of scale. My background, biology, and I tend to think of, you know, I think of the whole range of way in which nature is organized, from vast seas of plankton to rainforests to organisms with tighter boundaries, and at different scales, there are different needs. I mean, at what point do you need to hire somebody to keep track of the meetings and such? And at what point do you maybe need something else as the key thing? It sounds like you maybe never need a leader who thinks they're going to lead by dictating the plan. So anyway, I'm just putting that into the question along with verbs and nouns. And
yes, thank you, Leoma.
This is Beth. I can add a few thoughts. I think, Barbara, the book you pointed to, which is also one of my favorites, they do a nice job naming different types of networks and the purpose of the network. So, you know, one being like a connectivity network, which probably would be closer to a community practice. You're trying to find others who do like-minded work and connect and learn together, but there's not necessarily a joint purpose you're trying to achieve in the world. There's also value in like an alignment network where, and this is one of the elements of a network I find it's really important and we don't always get it, but it's this idea of, particularly when you're trying to achieve change at a much larger scale of a system, like June Holly, who's a really good thinker on this network stuff, says, you know, if you want to change a policy, build a campaign. If you want to change a system, build, you know, create a network. So that idea that the network's a place, all the parts of the system or a lot of different pieces can all come together and take the 30,000 foot view and see the whole together. And then go back, and that can affect what you go do in your own work, and you can find a zillion micro collaborations across the system to be more effective. So that's the kind of structure. It's not an organizational hierarchy. It's something different. So that's more like an alignment or a joint collective action kind of network form. So those are just a few high points of the definitions I've found helpful, and that book, Madeline Taylor's book, is quite good on thinking through some of these.
Yeah, thank you. So can I reflect to check for understanding here a bit? It sounds like you were saying that connectivity networks would be more like communities of practice. And this thing that you're calling an alignment network or a common purpose, you're saying by definition it wouldn't be like a community of practice because it's trying to be a microcosm of the larger system out there by having all these different players. And so that's a real interesting distinction between, like, are you trying to gather everybody who's doing the same thing, or are you trying to gather people who come from very different parts of the system yet want to focus on a particular kind of outcome? Is that close?
That's close, yeah. And in network theory, we talk about bridging or bonding. So bonding, you're getting people who, like, you know, like, sustainability, urban sustainability directors network, like all these people who do that job in cities come together in a professional network. In that case, they're still doing joint work, so they're not like, it's not only one or the other.
Got it.
Building connectivity.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
Kind of find things you can do together and connect people and help them self-organize and answer their questions. Whereas one, like the Vermont one, they were trying to get business and government and all the parts of the energy system in the state to come together and start to do learning together and see where they could all aim for similar goals.
Yeah.
And what those goals were affected what each group went back and did, because you realize, oh, if this is the leverage point and we all see it, you know, then we can change our strategy back at our organization to work towards that. And we can work with these five other parts of the system more effectively to go in that direction. So for me, that's the real potential of it when we get it. And so it's much more than just networking, which to me, that word conveys, it's more like a business. You know, I'm going to go to this business event and hand my card. But the networks that I see the potential of are much more where you're bringing the systems thinking and the strategy, and you're being very intentional about how you weave people together and, you know, what you're trying to hope to enable them to do while leaving a lot of space for things to emerge that you can't foresee in a good way, right?
Yeah. Yeah, thank you. There's a lot of value in these distinctions that are and clarifications that are being made here. So, Nancy, I want to go to you in a second, but I just saw that Forrest turned on his camera, which wasn't on before, and so I'm curious if you are wanting to speak, and you haven't spoken yet. So.
Oh, sure, and raise my hand as well. I'm slowly learning my way around the platform, so... and I'm really enjoying the conversation. I'm fairly new to this area, having really come from a career as a serial entrepreneur and been recently, a year or so ago, introduced into collaborative networks and kind of dived in deep from a study learning point of view, and particularly on the systems change. Quite passionate in terms of really climate change and also soil's role in facilitating the health of climate change and carbon sequestration and all of this, which is only at the beginning phase of actually being acknowledged and recognized of how important it is. And so I don't really have many stories yet that I can add and experiences with that. But at the same token, certainly looking to learn quite a bit and start reaching out to different people as the connections emerge. So I've got plenty of questions, but I'll wait that for another space. So thank you.
Thanks so much for being here, Forrest. I think we're all learning a lot here, so it's a great place for that. And Mike, I don't know if your camera was on, but you seem to be... more visible at this point, so I wanted to check in with you. Are you wanting to speak?
Yeah, not really. I'm just listening to the conversation. But the one thing I would add, though, my experience in working with groups and working in the spaces among organizations and, frankly, among networks, is that it all comes back to trying to identify and connect people based on their self-interest. And I think, which is a fundamental community organizing aspect, and I think identifying self-interest is real critical in getting beyond talk, whether you're working with a network or a local government or an organization, getting beyond talk and actually being able to take some type of concrete action. That's the only thing that's occurring to me as I'm listening to this, is that we really need to focus on the genuine self-interests of peoples and networks, whether we're connecting in the network or connecting among networks.
Great. Thank you so much, Mike. Nancy, you had your hand up earlier.
What a fantastic conversation. This has been great. Just a couple of thoughts have been occurring to me. I think that my own work at this point is, a lot of it is trying to make the distinctions we've been talking about and to be able to make them explicit, give them the different names, and appreciate the kinds of contributions each form of networking makes to the larger whole, and operationalize it, building off of stories. Stories as anecdotes are shared experiences, and also probably in time case studies, where we make kind of a systematic analysis of different kinds of experiences and what works under what circumstances and what are the minimum conditions that make a given kind of network work for a different kind of situation. At the same time, I want to note that it's a very, very evocative metaphor. And along with the analytic work, there's a lot of heart work. It's part of a much larger shift of consciousness that we're experiencing in the world, which has, I'll just name the two dimensions for me. Part of it is the overcoming the dualism that we've suffered from for so long, addressing issues of consciousness and spirit, and acknowledging that people come together out of their passions and their interests and this larger sense of connection. And the other part is, as I look back on our history, it seems to me around 300 years ago, with the period, with the Enlightenment and with the development of insights and tools for creating mechanistic, very effective mechanisms for working in the world, we created governments, our own constitution. As my husband, who is a constitutional scholar, and I've talked about what a mechanical metaphor underlies it. You set up a system and hope it just takes care of it, not a mechanical system. We've gotten a whole lot of benefit from that, but we're moving into an era when the network, again, coming originally from technology in part, and the mathematics and this theoretical work out of systems theory and so forth, defining sometimes in very precise and technical terms networks. And let me recommend to all of you the wonderful book called Linked. I actually am going to put it in our, in a moment I will drop it into the notes that we have. But very small, elegantly written, accessible book by a Nobel Prize winner on network theory that has tremendous implications for our work. The power of that metaphor is, and the lived experiences that it gives shape to, is shaping our sense of how all of society should work, how government should work, how community should work, and how we can literally share power among all people and have what I think of as minimalist enabling structures. The enabling structures have to be very carefully designed because they make everything else work. They are generative in nature. They put just enough order to keep the chaos creative. And the last comment that I'll make about that is that as we look at the way our energy flows through the systems and having just enough structures to keep us connected in constructive ways, we are finding the capacity, perhaps just in time, to make transformations fundamental enough to save ourselves and save as much of nature as we still can save. And it gives me joy and hope. And I find the conversations we've been having, whatever this particular kind of network is that we call D&D CAM, Climate Action Network, is a very fruitful place to connect and grow both our ideas and our actions, and most importantly, our relationships with each other.
Thank you, Nancy. So I need to do a little bit of a time check here because we're just about to move into the next part of our meeting where actually we're going to do a little bit of networking and Nancy will be facilitating that. But two people have had their hands up. Barb has had her hand up and Anna has had her hand up. And I need to apologize to all of you because it's my first time facilitating on Kiko Chat, and I just realized that there were two different places where people can put their hands up, and I have not been doing a very good job of keeping track of both of those. I've been seeing when people wave, but so my apologies to anybody who's been waiting a long time. So if we could have these two last comments, and then we will be shifting into our networking part of our meeting. So Anna?
I sort of part comment, part question. I was moved and intrigued by this idea, if you want to change a system, build a network, that Beth mentioned. And thinking about what kinds of networks actually change systems, I think that...
Call is going to go longer than I
thought.
Is that a problem?
Oh,
maybe until 7.
So I'm hearing something in the...
Yeah, if we could mute ourselves when we have background noise, that would be great.
Sorry. So I think that an essential piece of changing systems is modeling the new system. This is especially in the front of my mind today because I actually, Rosa, I just read your piece on participatory policy microcosms. And so I'm asking myself, you know, what helps a network model a different system? I think that having a really concrete set of new practices that are being experimented and iterated, like in the way that I experienced in the EcoFaith Recovery Network, for example, that's the strongest factor that I've seen myself, and I've also seen networks that want to be operating in a new paradigm be constantly pulled back from it by the fact that everybody in the network is also in all of these other social circles that have different norms, and makes it difficult to hold.
Yeah, so the value of concrete set of new practices and having in creating these new norms. Mm. Yeah, thank you so much. Barbara?
I am so moved by Nancy's words. I've read Linked. I think there is an order, a way to be together that is emerging. And one of the wonderful things about Linked is that it helps you understand how networks function at the micro level, and they function in the universe, and that we're just beginning to see the principles of a network and the potential of it. And the other thing I wanted to share is, we were talking before about the different types of network. The highest form they talk about in the book that I referenced is generative networks. And the characteristic of it that always stays with me is when you're taught about networking in business school, it's to connect with people to get something you want to take out. In a generative network, you connect because there's something you want to give. And generosity is what's valued. It's what becomes the currency of the network. So I think there's some really powerful ideas here.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Okay, and I'm sure that there's a lot more ideas, and it would be wonderful to continue this conversation, and we will definitely look forward to having it at the next one. And for now, I want to turn it over to Nancy for what we're calling networking here. And by that, we mean, people who may want to actually connect around specific actions, et cetera. And Nancy will be telling us more about that.
Yeah. Very simply, we set aside the last 20 minutes or so for a very minimalist notion of networking, which is simply the opportunity to share with each other events that we're aware of or projects or resources that we want to put in the mix, to ask for help, to offer help, and just an opportunity to make a brief connections at the end. I'm going to suggest that you can put notes as we're going. I still don't know how the chat works, but put notes directly into the notes column. So if you have a resource, write it in there. If you have a request or an offer, that way we've got something we can trace it back to. We're still learning how to use Kiko Chat as a tool for that purpose. So I'm going to open it up and invite those of you to have something that you're ready with to step in. Again, we're looking for, if a lot of you did this at the beginning, I was struck by the fact that it was almost a networking minute that came out of the query we originally asked, so maybe a bit redundant, but. Oh, you know what? I'll start it. I happen to have one. Today opens an MIT MOOC, a massive online open online course, and I will drop into the notes in a minute a link to it. It's called Just Money, and it's about new approaches to banking that make them socially responsible and socially generative. It's a 5-week course, looks pretty interesting. So who else?
I can go. This is Beth. I put in the notes up above a link to this great document called Net Impact, which is kind of a precursor to the book that Barbara's mentioning by Madeline Taylor and Pete Plastrick, and that has the definitions of networks that I mentioned in there on page 33. And I'll add some blogs that are really go-to resources. One of the other case studies that's really worth looking at, if you want to look at networks that change system, also in Vermont, Vermont Farm to Plate Network. If you look for Vermont Food Atlas, they've done a wonderful job putting everything online. And this is a statewide 300-person network with, you know, probably a whole bunch of different working groups and task forces, and it's going great guns. And it was inspired by RAMP, but went its own way. And it's a great example of economic development, agriculture, like sustainability, all those things linking together. And of course, the energy folks are also related to the food folks in a state that small, but that's another really nice one to look at for those examples. And then the third resource, I think to your point about the leadership principles and the ethic of working them, Leadership Learning Community, I don't know if folks here are connected to that group. They're based in Oakland, and they're doing a lot of work defining what are the leadership qualities and how do we develop leadership qualities for networked ways of working in the social change sector. So definitely recommend their website. They've got lots of resources. And I'm going to be doing a webinar with another colleague who does the kind of work we do sometime in the next 3 or 4 months on a topic related to that. So thanks.
Thank you, Beth. Could I just say, even though it got written in the notes, if you could, like, separately put each of the items with the correct name that you just listed, and please add your own website link for your blog that you've referenced several times. I would love to see it, and I don't know what it is.
And I just want to say, I've been trying to keep up with notes, but I can't take it all down. So these notes that I'm putting on KikoChat, they just hang there. So anybody can go in and edit anything I've written after the fact. So I'd encourage people to do that, because I just can't get it all. And some of the things went by me so fast that we're so rich. So
thank you. Please, please do that. And we'll try to pull some out and keep them in good order. Who else would like to?
This is Forrest. One thing I wanted to mention, I was looking and saw in the resources, the nextsystem.org. And I would have to say that at a meta level, they are doing some of the best work I have seen so far, really recognizing and acknowledging that first, all of our systems all around us are really experiencing high levels of dysfunction as measured by external metrics here in the United States. And two, that there are lots of very good, solid, proven solutions to most of the things that are breaking down. However, they're not being well disseminated. And so they're either on a local level or a regional level or something like this, and they're not really getting the impact they could. One of the things that's happening, that if this interests you in terms of looking at their website, be sure to check out what they're doing in the teach-ins, if that draws you. They had their first one about 2 weeks ago in New York City, and I believe they're setting them up in universities all across the country. I did see that the only one that they're holding right now, the only university that is sponsoring one in Southern California, is at the University of Santa Barbara, and it's going to be next week. So I plan to go over there and attend as well. But just in case there happens to be one in your area, I wanted to make sure that, I mean, they're in a, I think about a month-long period where they're doing many of these. And at least the Santa Barbara one is going to be simulcast also live. So it's, even if you're not in the area and there's certain levels of the content that you're interested in, it should be available.
Thank you. I have to say, one of the things I love about Zoom is the intimacy of sitting in each other's laps practically. And I'm loving sitting here with Sharon Joy's expression, which I see at least as this proud kind of serene, comforted smile on her face, kind of quiet little smile. See, this is what I mean. See how these things work. Okay, who else?
Well, thank you, Nancy. I appreciate that. And I'll just tell a brief story because I'll bridge on Forrest. It was Next System that brought us together yesterday, I think it was, Forrest, because he included me in a Kin's Network email about being on this call with Rion Eisler. And I said, I didn't see your name in the list. And I guess there were more people in this email than I realized who was in there. And one of them responded with this term, which I just laughed at loud hearing. He said, there's an upwising going on instead of an uprising. Well, it turned out it was Swami Benandananda. I'm on his email list because I really love to laugh and he is so clever with his language. I won't tell you all the details, but to make a long story short, he's going to be our Noetic Sciences person who's joining us, Kiko Chat from, where is he, Santa Barbara, Forrest?
He travels actually all over, and but he will be back here and actually staying at my home here in a few weeks for a week or two.
So
but
he's
right now he's in Northern California.
As of yesterday, one thing leading to another, we jumped in and he said, I said something about, we'd love to have you help us with this uprising here in Tampa Bay. And he said, I'd love to come see you in St. Pete sooner than later. And then one of the connection partners picked up and sent him an email and said, why don't you come for a Noetic Sciences program? So Bob is going to work on the technology so that we will expand on what we tried last month, which is using Kiko Chat and Zoom to invite people outside of our room to our Noetic Sciences program. So that's a little network on top of a network story.
Sharon, would you, I don't know how open the invitation to that is, but if it could include us, would you put the date and information into the notes right now?
It is Sunday evening, June the 26th. The time is 6:00 Eastern Daylight Time. And it goes till 8:30. We did it this past, the 9th of April. We were doing a tribute to Edgar Mitchell. And Bob was over there in Boca, and he was reading his eulogy. We had a man here in the room who was showing his pictorial photographs of planet Earth and his reference to Edgar before he even connected with us. That's why I'm saying this field is so fertile that plants and people show up without your design, just like wildflowers. And then you connect them and these amazing systems start to happen. So thank you, Forrest, for including me in the email and your friend Swami Benandananda, and he will be with us here in St. Petersburg. Yes, you will all be invited.
Linda.
Well, just an update to you, Sharon Joy. You know how I got so involved with the rate case here. That all came out of Skip Leitner, who I know you don't even know. But Sharon Joy, when we first got to know each other, she started sending me all these people that were living in Tucson. And I connected with this guy. And he's completely changed my life, by the way. He's an amazing environmental economist. And he flies all over the world. He has studied, right, he's with Jeremy Rifkin's organization. And he's got this whole new model of what's possible in the coming economy. And anyways, I just want to thank you for that, because I wouldn't know all the rich people I know in Tucson without that connection. I also just wanted to mention that Marty Roach, which is one of our other co-hosts, she hasn't been around the last couple of months because she's been on sabbatical. She donates so much of her time to climate change. She's quite amazing and just needs some time off. But I just wanted to mention that she got me involved with the TOP community, which is Technology of Participation. And I have actually become, taken some training with them, and I'm looking seriously at taking a program they offer this summer in Chicago. It's a very inexpensive program on community development and sustainability. So I don't know if any of you have any interest in that. I'm slowly kind of moving in that direction, and I might actually do it. So if anybody wants any info about it, well, I'll put it up on the resource section with the dates. And then one other thing I wanted to mention, our hosting team, in the beginning of May, when Marty gets back, we're going to be doing a little retreat, online retreat amongst us. If any of you have ideas, thoughts, things you'd like to see our network do, now's the time to send it to any of our co-hosts, and we'll take it to that retreat. And if you'd like to get more involved with the D&D Can, now's the time to reach out and let us know what you'd like to do and connect in with us. So we'd love to hear from you.
Linda, let me check in with you if I could. Do we allow a closing check out that we should be allowing time for at this point, or should
we do the
networking longer or what?
No, when we're done with networking, let's do our final reflections and then we'll...
So my question, I guess, was how much time should... It's 20 of now. How much time should we be allowing for the contacts?
Well, let's see if there's any other networking, and if there isn't, let's go right into closing.
Okay.
This is Andrew.
Hi, Andrew.
I see that Lucas's hand is up as well.
Andrew, go ahead, and then I'll call on Lucas. Andrew, did you want to say something yourself, or were you just... making sure that
I want to say something. I was giving precedence to Lucas because he was there first.
Okay, Lucas. Master designer of this lovely Kiko chat tool that we're all using.
It's great to see so many familiar faces and to meet and hear all those others that have chimed in. I was listening by phone until I got home. And there were many networks mentioned, and if this tool can help with those networks, please let me know. What I can give is my time to help customize the tool while it's still a little bit of wet concrete. There's more flexibility now. And I learned from you, and especially I've learned a lot from Bob, who has been one of the facilitators of this call, because he's pulled many features out of me to support his Florida Climate Action Network. So I look forward to that kind of relationship, people pulling features out of me. That's what you get, and then I get a lot in return, just learning how to make this tool better. So I really appreciate it.
Okay, Andrew. Thank you, Lucas.
Okay. I've thought a lot about climate change from a systems point of view, and I think that if we're going to change, actually solve climate, which is my personal commitment, then we need to change all the drivers that make climate change worse. So we're talking about what could be called a whole system change. To what? To a life-sustaining society. For that to occur, we need to get past the current polarities and get a critical mass of mainstream people on board. And my vision of how to do that is to organize not just a few groups, but thousands of groups, all championing education in some form, to help people understand the whole system change. To take that, to give it a goal, I'm beginning to organize, working title is A Great Transition Mobilization for March of next year. That gives us lead time to, in fact, engage thousands of organizations, train facilitators, get people prepared to do small things like emails or big things like workshops. And if anybody on this call would want to help take some leadership in that, we're all co-leaders, then let's talk. And the link is, I just added it to the list here. So thanks so much.
Thank you so much, Andrew. Anyone else?
This is David in Tampa.
Okay.
I wanted to share is that I really appreciated the distinction or the effort to distinguish between a network as a noun and a network as a verb. And I thank you for bringing it up.
Okay, I think we're getting ready to move into the closing, and you were going to host that, Linda?
Actually, Nancy was.
Oh, okay.
I'll just note that I think your comment, David, a comment of appreciation, just smoothly takes us into that. This is our opportunity now to hear from each of you. Any closing thoughts that you want the group to take away from you and your sense of what this day's conversation has meant to you or any lingering questions you would like to pose? We have 15 minutes until our closing time. Who would like to start? Sharon Joy.
Yes, I'd like to be a bridge, please. Because I waited for the networking to complete since I'd talked so much before. But Grady, I want to talk with you because I've been working with Jerry Friedman with the Elders Climate Action Network. And we're facilitating bringing a network of elders here in the state of Florida. And I was asking her, who was the person that organized the Massachusetts group that she told me about? Turns out I heard in the introduction, it's you. So I'd like to follow up with the Climate Action Network. And seems like there was something else, but I forgot.
Oh, I'd love to talk to you.
Oh, I know. Now Bob is into it. And so Bob has stepped in, and he's going to help organize with the elders. I know what it was I wanted to say. Some of you have heard me say this before. I'm really into emotional, social, psychic, spiritual transformation. And part of the pathway is to shift policy. And the power of voting blocks of faith, elders, or two I've been working on. I've now added mothers and youth. So the elders are extremely important. That's why we've been working on the Faith Network in Florida and why I know that elders can be really strong too. Thank you. Appreciated today. Bye.
Bob.
Yeah, it was interesting. I just had a conversation yesterday with people at the Elders Climate Action Network, and I've got another one on Monday about breaking down these silos between all these groups, because we will only be as effective as we are if we start working together. So anytime there's a group that's like-minded with a similar objective, I would like to get involved. So Andrew, I will be sending you an email. Just wanted you to know that, and maybe we can collaborate in some ways. As far as educating people, unfortunately, I believe that crisis is a prime motivator, and crisis precedes transformation. And of course, problems are also evolutionary drivers. I've heard it said before. So I think we need to focus on the people that are already sympathetic. Because until the water is lapping up against your front door, a lot of people are not going to pay attention to the climate issues because they don't see how it affects them personally. So anyways, I've been struggling with how to tap into the energy of people who are passionate about climate change, because they're the ones that are ready to roll up their sleeves and go to work. And I would sure to invest, love to investigate with other people how to find those people and tap into them, because it seems like they're the ones that are ready to help the rest of us get on board. So anyways, those are my comments.
Thank you, Bob.
Linda.
Well, this isn't my closing comment, but I did want to say that if you want to get in touch with anyone here on the screen that you've connected with, it's very, very simple. You simply go to the homepage of PicoChat and you click on their photo. That takes you to their profile, and then you can send them an email, and then they can send one back direct to you. So if you're wondering how to connect, that's how you connect. Just a quick comment. Thanks, Nancy.
Thank you, Linda. Linda, do you want to drop those instructions briefly into the notes? Pick up on them later?
Sure.
Thank you. Who would like to go next?
I've heard some comments. This is Andrew. I heard some comments from Forrest, but I don't see Forrest's name or picture on the list so far. And I'd like to. How do I reach you, Forrest?
I am there, and it's saying Living Earth. And I'll also put my contact information in the notes.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Quick question.
Yes, Miles.
Do those notes persist, and how would we get to them?
Bob, do you want to reiterate that, please? You're on mute. Bob, you're on mute?
Yes. Yes, it's pretty easy. The event that you're in right now doesn't get removed from PicoChat unless somebody deliberately does it. So everything that's here right now will be here for the foreseeable future. So as you scroll down on the events on the home page, you will see prior events. Find this one and enter the event just like you did today in real time, and there will be the notes. You can also, of course, copy them and paste them into a Word document or anything else that you would like to do if you want to have your own personal copy of it. And we will also be, I will be sending to Linda, I have been recording the video, I will be sending it to Linda, and I guess we will put it up in the cloud somewhere so it will be accessible through articles, links, and files.
Just to elaborate very briefly on that, Usually our co-hosts will collapse the notes and we'll leave them up there. So if any of you want to edit the notes, we won't do anything with them for a while, but then we will put it into the article section so you can find it there, as well as we'll just leave it up under past events. And let's see, there's something else I wanted to mention. We talked about how to email each other. Oh, I just wanted to mention again that if any of you want to stay over after the session ends, I can show you a few ways that you can work with the resource section and some other things.
And may I suggest in these last couple of minutes that if you are able to stay over, that you hold questions about the technology till then, and we can have this last few minutes for the closeout from people. So we have a number of people who haven't spoken yet. Beth?
Yeah, I just want to say thanks so much. This is the first time I've joined into this climate D&D dialogue, and mostly been on the listserv for NCDD, so it's really nice to see some faces I've seen coming across my screen, and appreciate all of you who helped facilitate it so seamlessly between each other and across the video, and it's really great to be connecting with people. And the network piece is something I'm really passionate about, as well as climate change. And so welcome any emails or whatever. If people have questions, I'm happy to connect you to resources. And I have a facilitation practice, New Directions. And I put a bunch of our blogs in the notes, but I also have a pretty nice resource page on there with a lot of links around network stuff. So feel free to check that out as well. So thank you.
And I'm going to call on you and then Grady on you.
Did you say Anna?
I did, Anna Barnett.
It's yes, Anna. Hello, hi. Hi, thank you so much. For me too, it's been a great first time and good to see people whose names I've heard or sort of circles I've brushed. Can I tag on something to the networking session? I didn't
quite get a chance to put something in just for a moment. I mentioned earlier, I work for Bay Area Nonviolent Communication, and we're working on this course, Working for Transformation Without Recreating the Past. So it's about how do you create real structural change and not accidentally just circle back around to the structures that you began with. And if you're interested in that topic, please hit me up because we are building a network around it. And I think it's going to be a really deep and rich class.
Anna, would you put that information into the notes, please?
Yeah, I will. I'll add a couple.
Thank you. Grady. You're not, you need to unmute.
I'm embarrassed that you had to say that. I'm feeling very grateful, having gained a lot, given little. But it occurred to me, there's one resource that I'll put into the notes that I just came across yesterday. The thought was triggered when it may have been Bob said something about people who are passionate about climate change. It turns out there's something called the Environmental Voter Project, which resulted from someone discovering that there are a lot of environmentalists who don't vote. And one startling statistic was that here in Massachusetts, there are 277,000 people who are identifiable environmentally committed people who did not vote in the last gubernatorial election, which a very not very friendly governor towards climate change won by 40,000 votes. So one out of six, had someone changed, gotten one out of six of those allegedly committed people to vote, it would have made a difference. So I've joined that project to try to become an organizer to help identify and get those folks out to vote. And I'll put the link. There's a good blog on the Citizens Climate Lobby website that called my attention to that, and I'll put that into the notes. But thank you very much for a rich conversation.
Thank you, Grady. I wanted to mention Climate Interactive, which has a phenomenally good slider, a simulator for looking at different environmental choices if you're unaware of it. I meant to mention it much earlier. Who else would like to go next?
And could we just mute whoever is doing a lot of typing, because it's amazing how loud it actually sounds in the background. So, great.
You know, I'm realizing, friends, I need to tell you all, I have a doctor's appointment in 23 minutes. So I am actually going to leave and turn this back over to Rosa. Do you want to pick up on the last of the closing out? And what I said earlier in my sharing is a very good closeout for me as well. Thank you all so much. I'm much deeply moved, and my hope raises so much. I'm so inspired after each of these conversations. So thank you for making a point of showing up and sharing so deeply. Bye-bye.
And I'll say likewise, Leo, leaving.
Thank you so much for your facilitation, Nancy, and for your wise and very thoughtful comments. So we're just finishing up in the last few minutes here, closing round. Anyone who hasn't spoken yet who would like to?
Yeah, this is Forrest. And I just want to express my gratitude and share and joy. Boy, thank you for sharing this information for me to be able to be here. The comments, learned a lot, and I am so appreciative of you, Lucas. I know about technology enough to know that this is by far the best of these types of platforms that I've experienced to date. And so thank you.
Thank you, Forrest.
This is David in Tampa. I wanted to really thank everybody, but also Sharon Joy for the wonderful metaphor of the bridge she wants to become. I would like to add that I would like to become the canal that goes under that bridge and irrigates other networks. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Sharon.
Beautiful, David. Thank you so much. Who's next? Have we all offered our closing thoughts?
This is Andrew. I'm just appreciative of the talent, enthusiasm, and great heart of people on this call and the larger network, but especially this call tonight.
Thanks so much, Andrew, and thanks for being here. Yeah.
I'll just say also thank you. I got encouraged again by hearing the scope of all the things that are going on. And just say quickly, if somebody is interested in the quantitative graphic interactive model of greenhouse gases in a city, we're not there yet, but that's what I'm working on. Contact me. We'll get it.
Great. Thank you so much, John. Linda.
I just want to say that, I think it was Beth said, when we started this network, I honestly didn't even know what a network was. And it was walking into an uncertain future. And it still is walking into an uncertain future. So I guess being in networks, it's scary, but it's also incredibly generative and incredibly fulfilling. So I just really am so happy to have soaked up all of these amazing pieces of information. And it's great. So anyways, I really enjoyed taking notes. Somehow taking the notes, I wasn't as active, but I have really enjoyed this particular session. So thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Linda. Okay, it's 7:00. Are we missing anybody who wants to squeeze in a final thought? Okay, well, we're ending on time, which is wonderful. I just want to say thank you to everyone. I have personally felt incredibly inspired. It's always a wonderful thing to see how much energy is latent and present in a group of people coming together for a good cause. And so thank you, each and every one of you, for all of the contributions and the learning and the inspiration and the heartwarming stories. And hope to see you next time that we have one of our monthly calls.
Yeah, thanks for facilitating, Rosa.
You're welcome.
And as people who want to stay in, we can go over a few things on Kiko chat. And maybe, Bob, if you can stay for a little bit. I don't know if you have time, but that would be awesome.
Let me add that Rosa, that date is, I think, May 17th. That's another Tuesday.
May
17th is our next conversation, and we'll watch what happens. Stay tuned.
Yes. Yeah, please send your thoughts, burning questions, anything you'd like to see us focus on next month. It'll probably take us a week or so to get the next session posted, but we'd love to hear your ideas. Which kind of takes us to how do we send each other ideas? So I just wanted to at least maybe I wanted to perhaps share my screen, or maybe Bob, you want to share your screen, and we can show people how they can send emails to each other. I think that would be very useful. And then I'm thinking we could also perhaps show them how they add resources. Those two things I think would be really important. Anything else that people would like to be walked through, now would be the time. Are there any suggestions or any things that people would really like us to go over on Kiko Chat, other than those things?
I'm going to say good night.
Okay, Sharon Joy. Thank you.
Thank you all.
All right.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Okay. Linda, why don't you share your screen? Have you done that before?
I have. So, okay, here we go. I'm going to share my screen with you all, I think. Is that my screen? I guess it is. Share screen. There's my son. Okay. So here's the Kiko chat. I'm going to blow this up and get back to the home page. So I've been taking notes.
How do I sign out, Bob? How do I sign out?
Are you on the phone? Just hang up the phone.
Yeah, this is David. I'm trying to hang up and sign out.
Well, are you on the phone? Is that the way you enter? Hang up the phone.
No, I entered through the smartphone on the webpage.
Okay, well, on the lower right-hand corner of the Zoom screen that says leave meeting.
I don't see it, but I will look hard.
Oh, just end the session then. That'll get you, that will terminate you too. Just end
I will try to
close your browser.
Okay, thank you, Bob.
All right.
Okay, so I'm on the homepage, and you'll see right under the upcoming and previous teleconferences, there are 50 members now. Of course, some of them don't have pictures. I would encourage any of you who don't have pictures to put them up. It's really nice to see each other. So let's say I heard something from Nancy, and I want to connect directly with her, and I don't have her email. So I would click on her picture. This takes me to Nancy's profile, and you can see here, write an email to Nancy, Gigi. So I would go ahead and say, hi, Nancy. This is a test email. We are demonstrating how to connect directly with each other. And maybe Lucas and Bob, I'm not exactly sure this myself. I'm assuming that this will not give my email directly to Nancy so that I need to type it in. Is that true? Or would they be able to, once I send this to Nancy, will she get my email or will it be coming from the Kiko chat?
Linda, just below what you typed, you'll see a note that's not very obvious, but it does answer that question.
Oh, they will see your email. Oh, I see. Yeah, duh. Okay, so then I don't even have to put my email there. I'm just going to send it to her. Success.
That's right.
I feel so good.
And if you make the screen perfect, and if you make the screen a little wider, then you'll see the close button where you can close her profile. There it is. That'll work. And at the top right, you'll see a little X when you go back to the right side of the screen.
I'm not sure I'm understanding what you're saying.
There it is. A little black and white X at the top of the screen.
Oh, and that's where I get out.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. So then I'm going to close that. It takes me back to the home page. Okay, so in terms of, let's say you want to add, you've thought about it and you didn't add it in our notes and you'd like to put something in our resource file. So you simply click up here on articles, links, and files. And if you wanted to really put anything in there, it can be anything at all. You hit on new resource. You can give it a title. Down here, you can go ahead and put in whatever it is. And we have listed some tags here. So what's nice about this, which we didn't have on the Ning site before, which is when we first got started, for those of you who are new, we didn't have any way to tag the material. So now we actually have some of these categories so that we can research on any of these. And I would say to you, if you have a tag suggestion that is not here, let me know, and I will make sure we add that tag to our tag list. See, what else can I show you? And then you just hit publish once you're done with the tagging. Anything else, Bob or Lucas, you think?
Yeah, then why don't you click on the blue button on how to upload a file or share a link?
Yes, let's say you have a link on your computer that you'd like to share. You can simply choose file. This will go right into my computer filing system, so I can take anything here. I might go into, I think I've got D&D can here somewhere, D&D Climate Action Network. I could go in here and pick up an article, summary of the Parliament of World Religions. I could put that right into the share link. I'm not going to do that because I'm not sure exactly I know what that's in, what's there. But that's how you would actually put in a link from your own database, or you might have something from the, you know, like a YouTube video or an online resource and put it right here.
Perfect.
And Lucas, maybe you could give us a little update on conversations. I know you're working on that. We haven't really done a whole lot with that yet. When will that be more developed?
I think it's ready to go. I can navigate you there if you hit the top blue button on top left. That's the button back to the homepage. You'll see conversations is the third link on the top.
Yes, so I'm going into that.
And then every circle has a main conversation. You can click it. And so that you can add a conversation starter. So there's a lot to say about what this tool does. Don't publish it though, Linda, because it's going to go out to everybody in your circle. But this is the idea right here. You've got a bunch of views, a bunch of really powerful ways to slice the conversation. I'm going to do a better write-up on it so people can walk themselves through. I'm going to create an updated video. But it's ready to use, and it's like a listserv.
So it functions just very fairly similar to the MCVD listserv?
It is. I think it's got some additional capabilities, such as you don't get every message unless you want it. You get every conversation starter. And if you're interested in that branch, that new conversation starter, you can click subscribe and just continue to get by email anything related to that conversation starter. And it'll cut down dramatically on the amount of noise of any conversation starters you're not interested in.
Can you walk me through, so I can walk everybody through, how you would tailor what you're getting? Because this conversation starter, if I publish this, it would go out to everyone, right? On their email?
Yes. There's a lot to say here. So at the top right of the screen, you'll see red, not subscribed. And just to the left of that, it says notification. So click there, and it gives you your notification options. So you can click anything here. It's not going to change anything except for you. So the first option, the fire hose, click on that and say send immediately. So now you're going to receive every email immediately. This is the main conversation for the circle. So by default, everybody's going to receive new conversation starters in a daily summary. And you see the other options. Maybe people want to subscribe to all replies to them, replies that match specific keywords. It's self-explanatory, but it's not familiar. People will have to pause and look at the interface to see what's going on, because this is different than a listserv because it has a web interface. I owe you a good blog post and video about it. So when you're done, you scroll up to the top and you can close it. In the top center, there's a little red, a little bit to the right. There we go. That'll close out notifications.
Thank you, Lucas. I really appreciate that.
You're welcome. I want to give you a good overview because this could be really powerful. You would have different subgroups having their own conversations, not interfering with each other. Just a lot of potential here. It's my favorite tool on Kiko, aside from the live event, which we're in right now.
And I think eventually we want Lucas to be able to set up subgroups. Is that something that's easy for everyone to set up, or is that something only administrators are going to be able to do?
Everyone can set up a subgroup. Yeah.
Okay, I don't know how much more time people want to stay on.
I think I'm going to have to drop off.
Yeah, okay.
Well, I will send you an email. I have a Dropbox. I'll put the video in my Dropbox and send you the link, okay?
Now, when I get it from your Dropbox, then I need to transfer it to someplace else, right? I've been doing that to YouTube thus far. Or could I keep it in your Dropbox? I'm still...
Well, if it's a video, why not put it in YouTube and put it on their server? I mean, you know, I only have so much space in my Dropbox. I'd rather not leave it there. Videos take up too much space.
I'm going to jump off, guys. But thanks for the tutorial.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll try to do this a little bit every time so we start all learning together.
Great. Thank you so much.
Nice. Good to see you, Anna.
Okay, I'll talk to you soon.
Thank you, Bob, for being with us, and thank you for hosting the technical side.
Okay, so long.
All right, take care. Take it off, Rosa.